So first of all, welcome everybody. I'm Jeff Nathanson. I'm the executive director of the Museum of Sonoma County, and welcome. We are in conversation this evening with Mercedes Dorame, who is an artist in our current exhibition, Landscape Awe to Activism. The Museum of Sonoma County is an organization that's been here serving the Sonoma County and North Bay region since 1985. We are a Smithsonian affiliate museum. Our collection is pretty extensive on Sonoma County art and culture and history. We have over 18,000 objects and artworks that we manage, maintain, and keep safe and secure. And we're working through programs to bring more of our permanent collection into exhibition space in order to share this an incredibly deep and wide-ranging collection with the public. So just if you're not signed up to be on our e-newsletter, I invite you to please do that. Then we will let you know every week what we have going on. Even if it's not in a physical context, you can certainly access everything we're doing online. And most of what we're doing is like this in a virtual context right now. Anyway, we're so pleased to have Mercedes Dorame with us tonight. Welcome, Mercedes. Mercedes was born in Los Angeles, as was I. She received her MFA from the San Francisco Art Institute, and her undergraduate degree is from UCLA, also a school I was proud to attend. She calls on her Tongva ancestry to engage the problematics of visibility and ideas of cultural construction. Dorame recently received a Creative Capital Award grant, and her work is part of the permanent collection of the Hammer Museum in Los Angeles, San Francisco Museum of Modern Art, the Triton Museum, the Allen Memorial Art Museum, and the De Saussay Museum, among others. She was recently honored by UCLA as an outstanding alum of the last 100 years as part of their centennial initiative, UCLA, Our Stories, Our Impact, and was part of the Hammer Museum's biennial Made in LA in 2018. She has shown her work internationally, and I also know, as I think many of the people in the audience tonight know, that she teaches at CalArts. Anyway, we are excited to have Mercedes here. She's an exhibiting artist in our current exhibition, Landscape Awe to Activism, which, as I mentioned earlier, you can view online. We are hoping that by November, at the latest, we can reopen our indoor galleries. And I hope that we'll have several weeks of physical viewing of the exhibition. And assuming that really does happen, we invite everybody to see the exhibition in person. But for tonight, we're really thrilled that Mercedes is here to share her work with us. We're going to have a conversation, and then we're going to open up to all of you for a Q&A. So without further ado, I know we got a late start here, but let's just get going. Mercedes, the floor is yours.
All right. Thank you so much. Thank you, everybody who is here. Faces familiar and new faces. As always, for me, I find these opportunities always helpful because it makes me stop and think and process my own practice, which isn't something that it sometimes feels like it's a luxury to be able to do that. So I'm going to share a presentation. As we were waiting, I might have edited out some slides because of the group size. I think it would be really nice to really have it be a conversation. So I'm going to try to get through quickly. If things pop up that need more explanation, I would love to hear those questions, and I would love to talk about it with all of you. So here we go. Okay. So I always try to think about when I do these, I hesitate because I feel like I have to start at the beginning, and some of you who know me or know my work or have heard me speak before know that I kind of start with this early group of imagery. And this first real series was a series I did about my grandparents. My grandfather is the Tongva descendant, and so a lot of my thinking was around my experience growing up with them and not really getting all the stories because, you know, they looked like this when I knew them. And at one point I was given these photographs and I saw my grandmother and my grandfather looking, I never saw my grandmother's hair down like my entire childhood. And so when I started to see these kind of cracks in the, the assimilated American facade that they tried to kind of portray, it was really intriguing to me. And it was also kind of this moment where you feel a bit sad because, there was so much shame around being Native. There was so much shame in admitting that history and that past. And it's like frustrating as a person who wishes they knew more. But then it also going through this process helped me to understand how the like culture, history, politics, and institutions around Los Angeles really had a huge impact on them and their experience. So this project was really about reconnecting with my memories, reconnecting with my culture, and trying to kind of reinfuse and re-kind of imagine and understand these stories and these memories that I had and kind of understand them in different ways. And it was also like, this is a photograph on the left side of my grandparents' house where I grew up. My parents like ran a business out of their garage. It was this gathering place for me and my cousins and the family. And it was only recently that I started to understand that this is kind of where my interest in land started, this idea of land, because in working on this project, I heard the story about how the neighbors sent around a petition for them, a petition against my family moving into this house. And so when I think of land now, I think of how important it was to have this gathering space, even though in this way it was familial. For us as a tribe, we're not fairly recognized. And so there's no land base, there's no sovereign space to be. And it also, my other work is as a cultural consultant on these archaeological sites where I worked with my father. And this is my father on the right and another tribal elder a little to the north, Charlie Cook. And I worked on these sites. And then this kind of literal intersection of land and culture like hit, because you're there for the development to kind of move forward, but you have this responsibility to take care of your ancestors, because often what happens is that your ancestors are being dug out of the ground. Not all sites involve human remains, but a lot of them do. So you're working with these objects and people who are your ancestors and trying to care for them and have them be treated in the best way possible, but you're only giving recommendations. That's the legal word. And so the kind of intersection of like culture and then land, and then what I really started to look at are the objects. And it's actually in thinking about this presentation that I realized how those three kind of components have always kind of at different times play different like priority, but they've always been really present and intertwined. And during this process, I started to really look at the objects that we were surrounded by. This isn't a documentary series about the process in the way that, you know, I'm showing things getting dug up or the burials, which I wouldn't show, or the remains or those things. But it was really about the cultural practice around that. And the reason why that became important to me in these kind of remnant artifacts, you'll see the red yarn kind of reoccur, is because the Tongva people don't have this really clear lineal narrative or story. There are elders, there are stories, there is history, but it takes a lot of, and it has taken a lot of kind of working those pieces back together. And for me, it was really important to be able to acknowledge the gaps and to kind of be empowered by them, being empowered by like filling them in how they needed to be filled in order to create something that was cohesive. And so, you know, I do apologize because I do repeat this story specifically about this image because it's just, it was really one of those pivotal moments. So if you've heard me speak before, you've heard this, but this piece of paper was in this area where we were going through this very large verbarial process. One line of the paper is a Tongva prayer in Tongva. The second line is an English translation. And then the writing on it is my father's handwriting, giving like the pronunciation of a word that was like sticky for him. And so there were all these layers of language, meaning, culture, history, personal and kind of collective experience. And when I took this picture, I looked at it, I was like, oh, it's Edward Curtis, it's the vanishing race, what am I doing? That's not the kind of idea of native imagery that I want to put into the world. And then it kind of became this moment that I was like, no, it's those prayers and words and experiences become internalized. And it's more of an empowerment so that the paper is no longer necessary. And I do always show this because it really catapulted me into this work that I did in the landscape, that I do in the landscape. And it was a lot of, again, combining the culture, the land, and these objects. And then on top of that, the experience of working with ceremony. And these are my grandparents on the other side, my mother's side. And they happened to buy a piece of property right in the border of our tribe and the tribe to the north of Chumash in this area that there was a shell midden in the backyard, which I didn't know what it was as a kid. But this is the hillside I grew up playing on because they moved there in the 50s and no one wanted to live there. And he was a school teacher and she stayed at home. So it was just this kind of, I had access to the land for really different reasons. It wasn't because my tribe had some sovereign space. It was, I had access to this kind of privately, but it still referenced the culture for me. And so I started working in this space and kind of interacting with it in ways that were, for me, always a collaboration. For me, about working in the landscape was always about inferring a presence and kind of inserting that presence and that indigenous presence back into these spaces. And then I broadened out and this is a fresh spring that my grandfather used to go and gather water at. And it has this beautiful boulder with, you know, clearly people made that grinding area there and it was used. And so I love to kind of point the people looking at my work to these spaces in Los Angeles, in my tribal territory, that are not your generally recognized spaces of Los Angeles. I like kind of pointing to these spaces that aren't necessarily recognizable in a broader cultural way, but then to kind of take my camera and point it at these kind of, the way I've come to talk about them is as ceremonial interventions. And for me, that's kind of a private individual moment. It's not necessarily that I'm recreating a Tongva ceremony in these spaces, but it's kind of this interaction that I have with the land and those spaces and how you reconnect and re-explore. And, you know, I always come to these spaces and they're always different. Like this is a spider hole that I came upon. And, you know, this is, like these moments of surprise and interaction, you can always see like the different imprint of the animals and pathways that are made. And so they really became kind of important to recode as native. And the way I use the photograph is a lot as a document of kind of the arranging. There's always, I've had this question a few times about like, what's more important? Like, are you doing a thing and is that the art or is the photograph the art? And I think that that's an interesting kind of discussion. But for me, the photograph kind of becomes this like document, this permanent record, this permanent claiming of spaces that I essentially lose access to because everywhere I've ever worked is always either temporary or at the behest of someone else, or as in this property, sold, and someone else lives there now. And so this catapulted me into these installations that I do, and I'm gonna go kind of quickly, I apologize. But I started working in these installations because the landscape, you know, the culture, the history, the objects, the land, and then I started thinking, how do you kind of take that a step in a different direction for the viewer? And so I started working with these installations, and I was really thinking about how we look at the night sky, how we look at the cosmos, how there's this like instinctive kind of urge to look up, and you know, you go out at night in a place where you can actually see stars, and I'm hard pressed to find a person that doesn't have that moment of just kind of speechlessness, right? And so I was working, interested in these objects, which goes back to my work on cultural sites. And there are these are photographs from an actual site where these star stones, which is what I've called them, they're technically called cog stones if you want to Google it. But these stones are found in our tribal area. They are really beautiful. They're really intricately made, and we don't know what they were used for. And for me, it was a kind of metaphorical or a really interesting way to talk about the fact that there was so much desecration and destruction and intentional quashing of our culture that even something this intentional, we don't know what it was for. So for me, they speak to kind of how absolute that was at moments. And so I started recreating them out of concrete. And this again goes back to land because, you know, when I arrange them on these surfaces, they become this concrete plane, which is what we all operate on a pretty regular basis that isn't very deep. When you see a road or a parking lot dug up, it's really not that thick of a surface you're operating on that separates you from the earth, the ground, the land. So I started kind of working in these and adding them in with the photographs. And for me, they give a different entry point. I'm still, like, I think the thing that is consistent is I'm always really intentional about the objects, the materials, and the kind of references that I'm making. But in the process of making, it's nothing. This kind of scares curators sometimes, so we can talk about this. I'd love to. But it's never super planned out. It's always kind of this process where I say, this is the general idea, but you have to trust me a little bit of what it's actually going to really look like in the end. And the beauty of that is these kind of surprises happen. This was an installation I was doing around the time when there was an eclipse, and I was thinking about how these stones could make these shadows. And then I moved the stone and the string would move, and that line on the ground actually isn't a shadow. It's from where cinnamon didn't hit the first time. So there's all these weird planes of optical illusion. I really love making these, and for, in a certain sense, they have the same feeling that I'm working in the landscape, but they have a really different end product, I guess, end result maybe is a better way to say it, and that is I think important because it allows the viewer to really experience the kind of three-dimensional, multi-perspective thing that they can't get because often I'm working in these spaces that are private. And this, I'm gonna go really fast with this. This was a performance piece, kind of installation, which was another direction that I actually was surprised how much I enjoyed. And I took these instant photographs of people and asked them to write what home was. Because for me, so much of when I think about home in Los Angeles and California, I think about place and my connection to place and literal connection to the land. And so I kind of expected to create like a map of like a, almost like coordinate points. But what it really became is this thing about, you know, home is where I feel accepted or where You know, I have boots and whiskey, or I'm trying to think of some of the more memorable answers. It was, you know, people got, it was not about place at all. And so it was a bit of a surprise. It was kind of a beautiful thing to create this kind of constellation of ideas around what it means to belong in a place and what that connection feels like. This is the last kind of thing that I'm going to show. In that same way of connection, belonging, land, kind of looking up, looking forward, trying to remain in the present tense, I was invited to do a piece at Frankel Gallery, which I don't know how familiar you are with that, but it's a very photo, it generally sells a lot, you know, shows photographic work. And so when Richard Mizrak, who curated it, called me and said, you know, do you want to do a wall installation? I thought, yeah, but I could just give you some pictures, you know, in like a frame, and you could hang them on the wall and it would fit really well. But I took it kind of as a challenge. I find that these moments where I'm a little bit afraid to walk in or challenge myself to do something really different end up really being rewarding. And so it was a show in response to this Carlton Watkins show that was in the other room. And so when I started thinking about Carlton Watkins, there's an interesting kind of, you know, moment, because, you know, these photographs were part of the reason maybe that Yosemite is a national park and it's protected and we can go there and access it. And at the same time, I know with Watkins' photographs, it completely erased the indigenous people who were living there at the time, right? Like, that's not really part of the conversation. And so in this, I was trying to kind of build this idea of a landscape and this night sky. And these are all photograms made with the materials that I work with kind of in these installations. And then I kind of use these negatives of Polaroids of myself. And I don't usually include myself. In fact, I'm very squeamish in front of a camera, if anyone who knows me knows that. But I felt like I had to kind of insert the literal physical presence, like indigenous presence. And not that that's my tribal era, and I wasn't trying to claim that, but I kind of felt like it was really important to include that. And it was really fun because I did this kind of installation and I found these postcards that I had collected that were also Yosemite. I don't have an image in here, but there's this one image I have of this waterfall. And in the other room, there's this like 24 glass plate negative image of that exact same waterfall taken by Carlton Watkins. And I have this tiny little kind of messed up postcard of it, but it also speaks to the awareness that we have around some of these landscapes and how important they have become, and these kind of mixing of found objects and yeah, just kind of speaking to that kind of importance and that connection and kind of re-understanding what those spaces were and are and have the potential of being. So I know that was a bit fast, but that's my last slide. I'm going to stop sharing my screen. I'm happy to pull something back up. But yeah, I tried to go quickly so that we could have time for conversation.
Well, that's great. Thanks so much, Mercedes. And it really gives us so much more information, background about your work and your motivations and inspirations. So I was hoping that you would maybe say a little bit more about the motivation and inspiration for you to continue to do your work, and what really your concerns are now, maybe as in comparison to what your motivations and concerns were early on. I mean, I thought it was really fascinating you talking about your grandparents and how maybe your perspective is now as a professional artist adult compared to where you were as a child and as you were coming of age.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like I'm always learning and I'm always kind of trying to be in that learning process. I feel like some of the bigger shifts were, one, that moment of feeling empowered by empowered by the thing that's supposed to make you not confident. So I was listening to somebody speak, and there was this moment where she said, you know, because of colonization, like, our language was taken away, the like spiritual practices were banned, and our land was taken. And then you're kind of coming around full circle and being told you're not authentic enough or real enough because you don't have those things. And so there's this moment where you have to like stop apologizing for not having those things and just kind of work towards anything you can to make that reconnection. And so I'm taking Tongva language classes right now, and I'm constantly trying to speak with other people and elders and community to try to understand better. And I think the biggest shift and like moment or impulse I have with my work is, so often Native people are coded in the past tense, you know, in writing, on websites, in history books, even in things that have good intentions. And that past tense slips in so easily. Oh, Native people used acorns for their food source, or Native people lived here in the past. You know, like there's these moments that really come really naturally into popular culture, or are just like the lexicon, because it's where they've existed. And so my biggest thing is to really relocate Native people and the Tongva people, especially in the present tense.
Well, that's really interesting. And I feel a certain sense of guilt growing up in Los Angeles, and still having very strong family connections to LA, and having gone to UCLA and really thinking I know the city, right? It's like, oh, I know LA. And yet in all of my years growing up and learning and interactions with people, until recently, I never heard mention of the Tongva. And the tribal land. And interestingly, earlier this year at the California Association of Museums conference, which was held at a hotel in downtown LA, the opening ceremony at their opening plenary session for the entire conference included a dedication and honoring ceremony for the Tongva land on which we were standing. And I thought, oh, that's so cool. I know Mercedes Dorame. But is there any kind of coordinated official or at least an attempt to try to communicate and educate and really share a almost completely lost, but now being, I guess, rediscovered cultural heritage and I, you know, it seems just so sad to me that there is so little of it known.
Yeah, I mean, the interesting thing that I've come to realize and is that I feel like maybe instead of lost, I would say hidden. It was almost like when I would think about these stories with my grandparents and then I'd kind of understand it through a different lens and be like, oh, that's why they did that thing. Oh, this is why all my grandfather's friends were they were all other Native people, right? So you start to kind of see that it wasn't necessarily lost in a sense. I mean, there were some things that were definitely like, quashed by like the missions and people coming west. I mean, that whole history of Los Angeles. But, you know, so I think what I would say is there's kind of, I would say the generation really before me, my father, some people on this call's relatives, or this, some really amazing people who continue to work so hard to kind of put ideas of being Tongva, even Gavrilino, as you know, the renaming by the Catholic Church around San Gabriel, put that back into the light, right? Take it away from like this like thing that was hidden and shameful, maybe of a generation before that, and kind of taking it out of that place and illuminating it again. And I feel like there's also institutions that are trying to support. I know UCLA has done this, has done a lot of work, and there's a land acknowledgement as part of, I think, most of the departments, or at least some of the departments that use on all their email. And I know there's controversy around land acknowledgements because people feel like they don't quite do enough. And I understand that criticism, but for me, it's somebody seeing Tongva or Tongva or any kind of recognition is good kind of building. I want to come to the day where I meet somebody in Los Angeles and I tell them I'm Tongva and I don't get a blank stare. Like, that's my dream. I mean, I have dreams bigger than that, but I really want to get to that day in my lifetime. You know, and like the California Indian Museum does a lot of school curriculum. Like, it starts young. The reason why I put that picture in the slideshow towards the end of the little flowers on the piece of bark is because my daughter gave that to me. She went to the park. She came home with flowers in her hand and some bark and said, "This is for your art." And when I was a child, I went to the museum and saw Degas, and that was art, which is also art. But I love it that my daughter appreciates that nature and appreciation of that is also worthy and part of what we should be focusing on.
That's great. Well, and it really prompts some questions. I have so many questions. But about your process and sort of the performative aspects of your art making, I do want to talk about the work you've done in a gallery space, but really I want to start by asking you to maybe talk a little bit more about working in the landscape, on the land, and the use of objects, cinnamon and string and what symbolic or personal or ceremonial meaning might it have? How you choose and why you use these certain materials in your work?
Yeah, I mean, I would say it has all of those elements. So I'll kind of try to break it down. When I first started working the landscape, it really began on this hillside, and I had a familiarity with it from childhood. I grew up playing on there. It was like the escape. All the kids would like go out in the backyard to like get out of the house, and the adults, right? And so then I started working on these sites where I was learning about archaeological practices, which was not my training. I was a literature and culture major. And so really, it was because I remember finding shells up on this mesa as a kid. And I think maybe I thought that the ocean was up that high at one point, and that's how I got there. But then having worked on archaeological sites, you're like, oh no, that's a midden. That's because people, that's like a trash, you know, pile where people were discarding the shells from what they were eating from the ocean. And I had this moment of being like, oh my God, like it had kind of washed away. It wasn't there anymore. But just that understanding of like, knowing there was literal human presence in this place that I grew up kind of also experiencing. And so the land was really important because, again, like I was trying to look at Los Angeles and show it in a really different way. And when I go to places to work outside, I don't also have a plan in like, oh, this is like the sketch of the image I'm gonna make. I go with my camera and my tripod and like a bag of stuff, right? And the stuff is kind of all of the objects and materials that do have cultural, personal, historic, kind of ceremonial at times references. And so I'm really intentional about the materials I use, but then the outcome kind of, I like to kind of let it live and breathe on its own. And so the red yarn I'll try to like name a few of like maybe like three of the big ones. The red yarn comes into play. If you remember the images from the work on the burial site, there was that table just filled with the pieces of red yarn everywhere. And it was because all of the sage we used during the ceremony was wrapped in red yarn. That's how it was gifted to us, which is a pretty common practice. It's not always red, but it's quite common. And so for me, all of that leftover material was referential to how many people were dug up from a cemetery so that really ugly houses could be built and a drainage ditch could go where they were, you know, buried. So it was really like, it pointed for me back to this really difficult kind of experience. And then also on archaeological sites, you often map out the earth into these meter squares, right? You put the square down on the ground with string and nails. And it was always this like amazingly bizarre practice to me, because it's like this hillside and then you put a square on it and dig this like perfect box out of it. I always say this, I kind of wanted to try to do it one time because I'm sure it's really difficult to make those like perfect walls. But you know, what does it mean to like excavate or look back or look in or focus in on? So it was kind of a focusing in moment. It also like for me becomes these like sinews, right? And I had an extra series, I didn't include it, but it's called sinews because, you know, so often we want this like really direct line of a story. We want that like arc that like makes perfect sense. And really the connective tissue in our bodies is really messy and tangled in a certain sense, but that makes it stronger, right? It's like, if it was just a straight line, it might be much easier to break, right? Or to make not functional. And so the yarn really kind of takes on these multiple meanings. And then as I started using it vertically, it was really this invitation to like see it as an idea of space and to also like direct attention of like up, right? Like how often do you stand in a gallery and look at the ceiling? I like getting people to take that posture sometimes and have that imagination. The cinnamon is kind of an interchange I have with ochre, and ochre was used quite a bit in our tribal area. There are these ochre caches. It was used on the body. It was used for painting in caves, which was often referential to like celestial movements. And at a certain point, I started thinking about how I don't have access to ochre. It's not a material that is easy to necessarily come by. And what did it mean? But the cinnamon was almost looked like, it's almost identical visually. And I was working with mostly photographs at the time. But then when I started using it in installation, it brings in the smell element. And every time I use it in a space, people tell me these stories of like, oh, it reminds me of this or it reminds me of that. And I love that it's kind of activating a different sense than what you normally get in a interior kind of art space. I'm trying to think what other thing. I use abalone shells quite a bit. There's a long tradition of using those for decoration. And there's, you know, I've worked on areas where, I mean, there's a diving history of, you know, amongst our people. And so these are the materials that I always kind of reference to. And sometimes I use things that are passed down to me or given to me by my father. But yeah, the objects and the materials are always very intentional.
Yeah, I assumed that they were, and I was just really curious about, you know, what those references were. So thank you. I found it really, emotionally intense to hear you talk about the desecration and destruction and these burial sites and just the I guess intentional quashing of history and culture, trying to do that tragic erasure that has happened all across this continent. So I was hoping that you might talk a little bit more about what that experience felt like and your connection to others who are involved in the process of maybe trying to, I don't know if salvage is the right term, but you know, those things that have been buried that are now It's like, okay, well, you don't want it to just go in the garbage dump because it has meaning and importance.
Right. So it's legally not allowed. It's legally not allowed to go in the garbage dump anymore. It used to be, but then there's NAGPRA, which came into play. And then there's another specific law that touches on California because California has so many unfairly recognized tribes. And so there's kind of like the legality around it. But really, for me, it was very formative experience. And it really is why I started talking about and exploring in an art context my, the Tongva part, because this was like really formative from a very young age when I started doing these working on these sites. And essentially you're there solely because of your ancestry. There's no formal training. I mean, my father trained me. He's been doing this work and continues to do this work still. And he brought me on and he trained me, but you're really there because of who you are. And you're actually like the one there really trying to slow things down, and people resent that because slowing down equals costs more money. So there's this constant tension between trying to get people to do the respectful thing and then, you know, navigating your influence, because like I said, you're giving recommendations. That is the legal word. So a recommendation can be taken or left, right? So there's this navigation that happens. And so there's a huge burden, a huge amount of responsibility. I've seen the toll this has taken on my father and the other people I know who've done this. It's really incredibly difficult work. And I don't even do it full time, you know, like it used to be much more frequent than it is even now. And it's really disheartening. I mean, I think that part of the reason why I make artwork and talk about these things is a way of processing it, because it's kind of crushing to watch that happen, to see people taken out of the ground. And sometimes the process is respectful and that people set aside land for reburial. And sometimes it's not. And those are the sites that like haunt me to this day and I have nightmares about. And it also really highlights the fact that we are one at the mercy of other like landowners, and I do put that in quotes, for a place to rebury our ancestors who are taken out of the ground that we don't want to be. And sometimes they sit in boxes on shelves for years and you get handed a bag. Well, I don't know why I thought, sorry. It's just really difficult. And it highlights so many of the issues around visibility, persistence, culture, respect, acknowledgement. I mean, all these things that are, you know, part of this conversation. But it really is the thing that catapulted me into wanting to talk about all these issues. It came from my experience the need to really kind of not just let that sit inside of me for the rest of my life, because I think it would end up being incredibly debilitating.
So I think it's so important to use the creative process, especially when you're dealing with things that are so difficult and weigh on you personally. How do you share that that artistic commitment and process, let's say, with students who might have a completely different cultural background and perspective, and yet your process and what motivates you to do your work might have some ability to inspire others, or at least teach them about the importance of that kind of work?
Yeah, I mean, so I worked with Henry Wessel, or we all called him Hank, at San Francisco Art Institute. And I always remember him saying, you know, wherever you're standing, wherever you're standing and looking from, that's like a unique time and place and perspective. And if you're really speaking from that place, you can't be derivative. There's so much self-consciousness in the art world of like, oh, that looks like something else, right? You go into a critique and you're like, oh, that looks like this work, or this looks like, and it's kind of like a backhanded compliment sometimes because people are like, oh, that's been done before, right? Like, how many times have we heard that? And, you know, I'm not saying this is everyone's practice, and I know people don't all work the same way, but the way I work, and, you know, I think the students that I end up working with who appreciate that is that, yeah, you have a perspective, you have a voice, you have these experiences, they're valid, they're interesting. It doesn't mean you have to make super personal work. Like, I started, like, I show that family work because I think it's really common to start in that place. Even with my students, like, a lot of people start with this idea, like, I'm looking at these family pictures, I'm like picking through this kind of fraught history, or this great history, or this thing that I can't make sense of. Like, it's a really, I think, human place to start an exploration. And I think it's a good one. And I think that, yes, you can find avenues that are interesting, and they might get really far visually or conceptually from like where you are. But I also like to tell my students and people that, like, everything that you have as an input, like, it filters through you, and that's what comes out when you're making. You know, I talk about music and podcasts and literature and fiction and these things that, you know, sometimes you're like, I'm an artist and I need to go look at only like visual art or like my own medium. And yes, those things are important. Like, I do also encourage that. But also, you know, being aware of your surroundings. Like, I was talking casually in the beginning about watching these butterflies shift from eggs basically to butterflies in my backyard. I got to see the whole process, and I've never in my life have I seen that. And in researching butterflies, like, so they turn, they get down to the cellular level. They completely lose form down to the cellular level. And yet in the migration, they don't make it the entire length of the journey in one generation. So that knowledge, that like ancestral knowledge of where to go, is literally passed down at the cellular level, which is really beautiful. And it's also something about being in that. Sometimes I feel like I'm personally, and a little bit collectively, we're in this kind of transitional, I'm teaching a class on liminal space, this transitional kind of goo period where it feels really uncomfortable and we don't know what's about to happen or how things are going to shift. And that can be really terrifying, but it can also be the most amazing moment to envision the possibility of what really can change in a really short period. Sometimes it's really hard to keep that in an optimism light with the world the way it is, but, you know, I try to think about how, what the potential is.
Yeah, we have to think of what the potential is and what is possible, because it's the only way you can keep your faith alive and, you know, keep hope and then work towards the change you want to see happen. So that's probably a whole other conversation, but just looking at the time, and I see that there's some questions that are starting to be added to the chat function here. I want to invite everybody who's joined us, please go ahead and either put your question into the chat, and we'll call on you, or we're going to open this up now and allow people to, just because it's a small group, to I'm actually going to go and do gallery view so I can see people. I do know, Connie, you have a question in the chat, but maybe you want to just unmute yourself and ask it out loud.
Hey, I was wondering if, and this is just because this is not anything that I've read about, but I was wondering if the U.S. government has any plans to make restitutions to your tribe, your family, you. What's the status?
Yeah. Yeah, so like, as many tribes in California who don't have federal recognition, many people and tribes have gone through this process of trying to get that. My opinion is the government makes that near impossible. Even people who put together these kind of very expensive proposals or packages to the government still somehow don't get it. So that's been like the path somewhat historically, you know, recent historically. There is a bit of acknowledgement from the California government specifically, right? We had this acknowledgement that with the word genocide was actually used, right? Which was a big deal. But then on the heels of that, there was a law that came through that was really detrimental to unfederally recognized tribes. And so there's still this kind of tension and volleying. And I'm not saying those were the same, like it wasn't the governor who did this law, you know, like, but policy-wise, there's this constant kind of push and pull for recognition. And, you know, I kind of think there's a lot of politics around that. I could probably talk for like a good hour just on that, but I won't do that to you. Some of it has to do with, you know, you're federally recognized and your tribe's from Los Angeles. What land, you know, what is it? You know, like who's gonna let go, right? I think that sometimes the reason why so many times you get this hesitancy of inclusion because people are pretty much nervous about you asking for land, basically. There's a bit of momentum around that being more part of the conversation, which I find encouraging. There are some tribes that are doing land trusts, right? Like there's these kind of alternate pathways that people are trying to find in order to find, you know, but essentially the treaty that was supposed to give us our land was like shoved in a desk and like forgotten about. And that's why it didn't happen. Mm-hmm. So it's like this really, and then, yeah, I mean, again, I could talk for an hour on this, but it's a tricky moment. I feel like the federal recognition thing is so fraught. And so me personally, I'm like, how else can we do this? Like, how else can we shape this to make it something that can be, you know, seen and like come to fruition.
Great, thanks Mercedes. We have time for one more.
I would like to ask one actually.
Yeah, please.
What legacy do you hope to leave with your art, or how do you think your art has impacted other Native artists that you've met over the years?
Interesting question. A couple of my Native friends are here, one who is also Tongva. so I don't know how to answer this without referencing them. As for legacy, like I said, my real big thing is to like move things into the present tense. It's really difficult to talk about some of these things because one, you're not the bearer of all Tongva knowledge, right? Anyone who's speaking at a cultural place always kind of has this moment where you're like, I'm not the sole voice, right? But I know that having a chorus of voices is really important. And so there's always this kind of balance between, I mean, that's why I really try to speak about these kind of ceremonial interventions in a personal way. And it's not that I'm, you know, performing this idea of a Tongva ceremony for display. So it gets really, it's hard to kind of make that line, but I do feel like there are certain things that are to be shared and certain things that aren't. I even like, you know, it's like answering a question about Playa Vista is really tricky for me because one, it's very much in the news and you can Google it and read all of these stories about it and, you know, but I have this personal context, like this deep personal context. But like I said, I would never show any, like I didn't actually show the process. It's like, it was just the kind of environment and the objects that were peripheral, sounds like not important, but that were not actually part of the archaeological or like the human remain kind of process. And so I think that I learn a lot from other Native artists. I constantly try to have a community of people that I hope that if I ever said or did something that was, you know, out of line, that like, that, you know, that's what community is for. You know, I think that that's why we surround ourselves with people who care about us and who we care about and who also are strong, because you need that. Sometimes I see artwork, I'm just going to go there because it's late and I've been talking for a while, but you know, the piece that Sam Durant made of these gallows, and you know, he teaches at CalArts, and I sometimes wonder if I should be associated with that institution for that reason. And I wonder, like, how did it get that far? Why was there nobody that said anything? You know, so it's always hard putting yourself out there, and I do try to be vulnerable and talk and speak from the heart, because I feel like, what are we doing if we're not doing that? But I do also always hope that, like, I never want to work in a vacuum. And I always hope that, like, we all influence each other, especially when it comes to people talking about Native politics. Because, yes, there are a vast number of tribes and huge differences between religious practices and origin stories and patterns and visuals, but we all kind of fell under the settler colonialism that is the United States of America, right? So there's also this kind of shared, I think, passion and vision of what of reclamation. So
thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you, Mercedes. And actually, I really like this idea of ending on a note of working, living, being inspired by one another in a community. And we all have our own families and communities, our circles of friends and people who, I loved what you said, Mercedes, about people who care about me and I care about them. And so it's something I think is also really important to think about in terms of the art community. And we certainly are trying to do that through the exhibitions and programs our museum shares, and trying to invite people in from all different backgrounds with cultural and you know, geographic and gender and age and, you know, all of the different perspectives that people have. It makes our world a richer and just more inspirational kind of a place in which for us to hopefully grow and thrive. But we have so much work to do to try to make up. We never truly can make up for all the damage that has been done, but we're so thankful that you're sharing your work with us, Mercedes. So thank you for being here. Thank everyone who has joined us for tonight's program. One thing I will mention is that we are doing everything we can as an institution to provide these programs for free, and yet it does cost money to do it. So if you feel so inspired, John has put in our chat how you can donate online. You can donate at our website, or you can text program to 91999, and every little bit helps. So thank you very much. And so we're going to sign off now, but I just also want to thank John and Jenny for being our team to keep this program going, and thank all of you who have joined us. And Mercedes, we're so grateful to you for sharing your work, your personal story with us.
Yes, thank you, everybody who came. I really appreciate it a lot. And thank you for the, yeah, just all the generosity and everything you're doing at the museum. It's been so much fun. So,
yeah. It's a pleasure. All right. Good night, everybody. Thank you.
Bye.